Open the meeting. May the Supreme Legislator grant that we be worthy of our power and responsibility, that we deliberate and achieve with wisdom and understanding, recognizing the rights of all of our citizens with full regard for the dignity and justness of the individual. Please join us for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Councilor Sullivan, did you read the minutes from the previous meeting?
I did, Mr. President. I find them to be in order and move that they be placed on file.
And there's a motion by Councilor Sullivan, a second from Councilor Masick. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Those will be those opposed? That'll be placed on file. And Councilor Daley O'Brien, would you do the honors for tonight's meeting?
I will, Mr. President.
Thank you very much. Madam Clerk, the Eagle Tribune has a statement to make.
Well, I'm just looking to get the council's approval to record the meeting, if at all possible. Peter Francis, 100 Turnpike Road, North Andover.
Make a motion.
And there's a motion by Councilor Barrett, seconded by Councilor Daley O'Brien. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
Thank you.
And Madam Clerk, first item.
Confirming appointments, Board of Appeals Associate Member Louise C. Bevilacqua. This is a confirming appointment.
Move confirmation.
Second.
Second.
A motion by Councilor Masick, seconded by Councilor Daley O'Brien. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Scatamaccio.
Yes.
Councilor Barrett.
Yes.
Councilor Masick.
Yes.
Councilor Ryan.
Yes.
Councilor Sullivan.
Yes.
Councilor Daley O'Brien.
Yes.
Councilor LePage.
Yes.
President Mitchetson.
Yes.
8 yeas, 0 nays, 1 absent.
And that passes. Next item.
Non-confirming appointment. Energy Advisory Committee Chairman Frederick Paris and Bike Committee Chief Richard Borden.
Move those be received, placed on file.
Second.
Motion by Councilor Masick, seconded by Councilor Barrett. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? That passes. Next item.
Petition from those opposed to a medical marijuana dispensary in Haverhill.
Okay, before we get to that, there are three related items that are on the agenda, somewhat related, I guess you could say. 7.1, those opposed to the medical marijuana dispensary. 7.2, those in support of it. And I'd also like to bring up item 16.1, which is the mayor's letter. And I do have a few ground rules for tonight. First of all, we'll address each of those items in the order that they're on the agenda. The council is not making a determination of whether or not a dispensary can be located in Haverhill. That won't happen until the special permit process. Citizens are free to present their perspectives. However, they should know that their comments won't be considered until they're presented during the actual public hearing for the special permit. Each side can have up to three concise speakers. And just a note for my colleagues, the City Council does not want to introduce prejudice into the special permit process, so we should keep that in mind. And there'll be no public input on item 16.1, the mayor's proposed letter. So, Madam Clerk, we now have 7.1, 7.2, and 16.1. Let's start with 7.1.
Petition from those opposed to a medical marijuana dispensary in Haverhill.
Good evening.
Name and address for the record.
I'm Deborah Maddox, and I live at 122 Lakeview Ave. Thank you for the opportunity to present this petition with the signatures of 543 Haverhill residents who oppose the medical marijuana dispensary in Haverhill. Like many of you, I grew up in Haverhill, and I'm proud of our city. I moved back here 10 years ago, and I'm very happy to be back here. But over the last few years, I've been deeply troubled by the decline occurring in our city related to drug addiction and drug trafficking. We have people coming here from all over New England to buy heroin. We had a methamphetamine clinic operating, factory operating in the middle of our town for many months. We've watched blatant drug activity occur in our neighborhoods and in the parking lots of many area businesses, including Market Basket. Now, if a medical marijuana dispensary opens here, we'll have people coming here from all over New England to buy medical marijuana. Yes, it is medical marijuana, but as we know from Colorado, medical marijuana gets diverted all the time and is sold on the street as a street drug. There's a reason why the respected professionals in our town, like Chief Denaro, the school health teachers, and the school addiction counselor, have advised against locating a dispensary here in Haverhill. Perhaps we should listen to them. We have good things happening here in Haverhill. The Woolworth building is finally gone, and we have Harbor Place and a beautiful new school that are about to be built. It seems like allowing a medical marijuana dispensary to open here is taking a huge step in the wrong direction. When I spoke with people about the petition, I frequently heard several concerns. Many people support the concept of medical marijuana, but agree that Haverhill is not the right place to locate a dispensary. Many people raised the questions, why does the city want it here? Is it because of money? And if it is because of money, how much is enough money to deal with the negative impact that the dispensary will have on the community? We shouldn't do the wrong thing for the right price. Another area that people expressed outrage about was the lack of public input and transparency in the process that got us to where we are today. That's why we're here tonight. People expected what the DPH expected, and that was open and public meetings to allow a community to decide if it wanted to host a medical marijuana dispensary. We never got that chance. As a nurse, I know intimately the suffering that is caused by cancer and other debilitating illnesses. Our mayor has shared with us that he lost his father from the devastations of cancer. I understand that. I lost my sister at age 40 to cancer. I'm sure that we all agree that access to treatment during illness is a tremendous part of the battle. Is not only a tremendous part of the battle, but a right that each patient is entitled to. With dispensaries providing home delivery and opening facilities in Lowell and Salem, our opposition does not block anybody's access to medical marijuana. But what we are doing by opposing this dispensary here is trying to prevent another kind of suffering, and that is the suffering of addiction. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next speaker. Name and address for the record.
You betcha. My name is John Cuneo. I live at 20 Hyatt Avenue in Haverhill. I'm opposed to the marijuana dispensary in Haverhill. Although I have a lot of empathy for those who feel that marijuana has done wonders for their particular health condition. As Dr. Maddox has stated, surveys have shown that more than 90% of those using medical marijuana are young adult males. Hardly the profile of those seeking relief from nausea, for example, due to cancer treatment. I feel certain that beyond what is available right now, as Deb Maddox has talked about a little bit, further access will come soon. I'm in no rush, as you'll be clear as I speak further, to trade that progress for the well-being of another generation of children and youths. The data on the impact of medical and recreational marijuana upon Colorado and a few other states is just beginning to emerge. As characterized by one individual in the media, it's a huge social experiment. The results are very cloudy at best, with both sides claiming they are right. I'd prefer to wait and see a little bit longer. I see medical marijuana as a Trojan horse for legalizing recreational marijuana. I have a son living in Colorado, and I'm very troubled by what I see. I don't, he's fine, just to clarify. He's in great shape, but I'm troubled when I go there and see what's happened to the communities. I don't understand why medical marijuana is not funneled through our current pharmacy system. The ostensible reason is that the federal government sees marijuana as an illegal drug. From what I understand, that's gradually being dealt with in Congress and the administration, and I don't see the need to start up a whole other system simply to serve medical marijuana. Frankly, I have little respect and confidence for the proposed vendor, as others in the media have noted their conduct to date and their record have not inspired my confidence, and I don't gather it's really inspired a lot of your confidence either at times. From 1995 to 2003, I directed a series of federal and state alcohol, tobacco, and other drug abuse prevention programs, demonstration grants for the federal government and the state government in Haverhill. I also served as staff to the Mayor's Drug Task Force for a significant period. As with so many complex social problems, there is no one silver bullet that will cure or solve this problem. It required, and still does today, a comprehensive collaborative effort of the schools, whose health representative opposes the dispensary, the police, the chief has opposed the dispensary, health practitioners whom, to my knowledge, only Dr. Maddox represents a local competent practitioner, who's appeared before you, community agencies of which I represent one, neighborhood groups. I know that Michael represents the neighborhoods to some extent, but I feel confident that he would work with whoever was working to try and prevent drug abuse and drug problems in our community, because he truly is a very citizen, community-minded person. And every other facet of the community working together. So all those facets working together, and what I think you've heard in general is that representatives of those facets largely are opposed to it, and I think that ought to count for something. We made some good progress doing those grants, but these were demonstration grants, and eventually the funds were no longer plentiful. The attraction of drugs are generational. In part, I see the heroin epidemic sweeping the country as that generational return. Realizing the tremendous toll these opiate drugs are taking on today's youth, the federal and state governments are beginning to reinvigorate prevention efforts and put some more money towards it. But at the end of the day, one simple prevention step is to keep drugs out of the community. Our community's youth and young people are struggling to deal with marijuana and heroin now. I think it's a terrible idea to add a new means of obtaining drugs locally. It's just simple common sense that if you want to reduce the use of something, take food, for example, in the case of dieting. Just don't have it around. I have trouble keeping my weight in check. You might not believe that, but it's true. I've found that the single most effective measure to help me do that is to reduce or eliminate the amount of unhealthy candy, ice cream, and other such foods from the house, and replace them with healthy fruits and vegetables. Similarly, if we don't want our children to use marijuana, not having a dispensary locally will make it just that much harder to access. Please, I urge you respectfully, exercise your responsibility as parents and as the official quasi-fathers and mothers of Haverhill to reject this and all other dispensary proposals. If you say Haverhill cannot, I find that hard to accept. Lawrence did so. It will not be accurate to send a letter of non-opposition, as clearly there are a number of Haverhill residents and voters who are opposed. And I apologize for that last comment, because I know you had ground rules, but I didn't know those ground
rules. That's fine.
Thank you.
Just
Let me just clarify the ground rule. When we get to item 16.1, that discussion will be between the mayor and the city council. We won't have public input.
Thank you, John.
John Maddox, 122 Lakeview Ave. Thank you again for hosting an open forum where both sides of this controversial debate can be aired. This should have occurred months ago when it was just us, the citizens of Haverhill, before we faced the pressure of a company whose profits are being threatened. Many of these issues can be debated endlessly, but one fact beyond opinion is that the process in Haverhill has not been transparent. After the 2012 vote on medical marijuana passed, the Municipal Mayors Association, the organization of which Mayor Fiorentini is currently president, recommended two things. The DPH should hold a public hearing in the host community prior to issuance of a registration. Number two, the DPH should give the highest level of consideration of the demonstrated level of municipal support in deciding whether to issue a registration. We all know these steps were not taken in Haverhill, and it's no wonder why a behind-closed-door process was chosen over a transparent one. Anyone who asked, do Haverhill residents really want a dispensary here? Would it really pass a local vote? Would have found out what we found out through this petition, many do not. You will hear over and over again that a majority of Haverhill voters approve the concept of medical marijuana, and that's true. Colorado voters approved medical marijuana statewide, and each town then voted on whether to host a dispensary. Massachusetts voters approved gambling statewide, but each city in which a casino was proposed had to vote on it. Marijuana proponents manipulate the 2012 vote. They want you to forget that the intended local input process was bypassed and then hijacked. There's an old mantra that if you repeat a distortion over and over again, people will eventually think it's true. Haverhill voters have never approved a dispensary being here. They were never given a chance. The 2012 conceptual vote passed in Andover, Methuen, Newburyport, and many neighboring communities, but none of them is debating medical marijuana right now and having a dispensary in their town right now because their elected officials did not volunteer their towns for a dispensary like Haverhill's did. We all know the story of how then Council President Scottamaccio was duped into signing a letter that gave Haverhill the green light for a dispensary. Now that the council has revoked that letter, the DPH has no letter on file regarding Haverhill's interest. That gives us more time to reflect and learn from other dispensaries. The council has wisely held the position that Haverhill does not need to be the first in line. Once a new letter is sent, the green light for Haverhill is back on. And while I respect that Mayor Fiorentini has publicly apologized for past actions, it seems profoundly unjust that this is being allowed to proceed given its origins. There is a concern about delaying patients' access to medical marijuana. No one here wants to stand in the way of patients getting something to which they are entitled. However, delays in access to medical marijuana statewide has resulted from a flawed process statewide. And it's not Haverhill's job to fix the DPH's problem by hastily approving Healthy Farms permit. Since the 2012 vote passed, the DPH did develop a plan for patient access that ensured a dispensary was within 25 miles of every resident, with dispensaries opening in Lowell and Salem, and with home delivery available. If a dispensary never opens in Haverhill, no patient will be denied reasonable access to medical marijuana. Haverhill's is redundant. Later on tonight's agenda, you will be asked to consider a new letter of non-opposition, all in support of Healthy Farms as an eventual applicant. During the special permit process, you'll have to consider if this is the company you want to welcome to our city. They've contracted with people whose marijuana license was revoked in Colorado. They've misrepresented or duped at least four local officials. They've been fined by the state for not complying with disclosure rules. That's who's proposing to be your new neighbor, our new neighbor. I'm concerned that any action taken by the city now, any item of implied support that mentions Healthy Farms by name, might prejudice the special permitting process and move Haverhill one step closer to being forced to accept certain outcomes. We hope the special permit process allows this council to ask Healthy Farms the hard questions necessary to determine whether past behavior predicts future behavior. You may be pressured to authorize this letter with threats that you will lose control of the process and the state will somehow force your hand. Governor Baker's administration, especially Attorney General Healey, is cooler to marijuana policies than their predecessors. We have heard assurances from Representative Dempsey's office that a dispensary will not be forced on Haverhill until a clear signal is given that we want one. These are the threats of a company whose profits are in jeopardy and which is using every tool in its arsenal to make you forget their past deception and your past good work. You will also be pressured to consider promised city revenue from Healthy Farms. The mayor's newsletter poll circulated a number of $500,000, but the few actual host agreements in other communities are for $50,000. That's a big difference. And you should get promises in writing before you make decisions from money pressure. Is this money guaranteed, or is it conditional on their profits? Is it for 1 year, or is it for many years? Right now, it's phantom money that's being used as a weapon against any opposition. Some believe that this dispensary is inevitable and it's too late to change course. But in contrast to much that has happened, we have seen this city council make wise and courageous decisions. The last time we were in this chamber together discussing the marijuana dispensary, this council scuttled the schemes to locate a dispensary on Hale Street. Cornered into creating a zone, you made the best of a bad situation. You didn't cave then, and you don't have to cave now. I'm proud of our petition and the work invested. You all know and appreciate the door-to-door grassroots conversations involved in getting old-fashioned signatures as a volunteer with no paid staff and no financial gain in the outcome. Following us, you'll hear about a petition of those in favor of the dispensary. After our petition was submitted to the city clerk, Healthy Farms finally became interested in public opinion. Unlike our petition, which was initiated and disseminated solely by Haverhill residents, the other petition engaged paid staff, online signatures, and out-of-town resources to demonstrate support for other points of view. As you compare and contrast the petitions, please note that each of our signees is a Haverhill resident who has listed address and or phone number. You will also see that the signees represent the breadth of Haverhill's neighborhoods and diversity. The bottom line is this: the city is split. And this is when democracy is supposed to work. This is when the government of, for, and by the people is the most critical, when we're divided. But those who wanted a dispensary here have found a way to slither by the messy work of public debate, and they're at it again. They know if you send this letter, the floodgates are back open. The green light is back on, and it will be more difficult for you to deny Healthy Farms their special permit. And it is discouraging and maddening to think that after all we've been through, they're going to get away with it. The council has done its job to create a zone. The ball is in the court of the applicant to begin the special permit process without further preferential treatment and red carpet. The DPH has no letter on file for Haverhill, and that's somebody else's mess that you shouldn't have to clean up. Please remain agnostic. Perhaps there's a way to get a better company to apply. In the end, there is a voice that the dispensary in Haverhill is unwanted, unnecessary, and unwise. And we want that voice heard, not muzzled. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I want to thank all three speakers. Mr. Vice President.
Thank you, Mr. President. I just want to clear something up. The letter I signed was not to allow a medical marijuana facility in the city, but the letter I signed supposedly was to extend the moratorium so we could do exactly what you want us to do, to give the city government some say in where it goes and who gets here. So I just want to make that point, Mr. President. I don't, whether or not I'm for medical marijuana or not, I just want to make it clear to everyone what the intent of that letter was, and it was only to extend the moratorium so we could study it more and we could do the things that all three of the speakers had mentioned and suggested we do. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Vice President, for that clarification. And so that ends item 7.1. 7.2, Madam Clerk.
Petition from those in support of a medical marijuana dispensary in Haverhill.
And we'll also allow for three speakers.
Okay.
Samples?
I'm afraid not. Well, unless you qualify according to your doctor, you won't be able to get samples at any dispensary across the state.
Your name and address for the record.
Absolutely. My name is Matthew Allen, and I'm a Boston resident. I grew up across the border, New Hampshire, not far from here. But the reason I'm here is because I've worked with medical marijuana patients in the city. I'm president of the Massachusetts Patient Advocacy Alliance, and so I've been working on this issue for over 6 years, traveling around the state. We're the group that actually wrote the petition and brought it to the voters. Some of the people I know in the region who are potential patients include Haley Osborne, who's an 8-year-old who has potentially fatal seizures, who all treatments has failed for her. We've seen in Colorado children with the same condition respond well and are improving and finally getting some relief. We work with a woman named Janet Van Stray, who's spoken here before, lives just a few blocks down the road, who deals with chronic pain and is trying to get off the very harsh, toxic opiates. And a lot of patients we work with, that's their big problem. They've been on these opiates. They talk about walking around in a zombie-like trance and then getting access to medical marijuana and getting their life back. We work with a veteran named Troy Mathewin, who had that experience. He was injured when he was in the Navy. He was put on all kinds of medications for neuropathic pain that caused digestive issues and other issues, and he really couldn't even care for his kids. With the medical marijuana, he's gotten off all those pills. So, you know, the opponents have said that there is sympathy for patients, so I don't want to spend too much time going through these patient stories, but I would disagree. I mean, that a dispensary here is unwanted, unnecessary, and unwise. It is certainly necessary for those patients, and despite the presence potentially of other dispensaries in the region, we do have an issue with the amount of medicine and serious concerns about shortages. There's no way that one dispensary in Salem can provide enough medicine for all the patients in the counties around the area. But in terms of the dispensary being unnecessary or unwise, I'd just like to indicate that when we put together, when we wrote the ballot initiative language, we had a strict public health approach, and that's why it was supported by the Mass Nurses Association, AIDS Action Committee, Leukemia Lymphoma Society, and other public health groups. What we did is look at the best practices from around the country and take those all and put them in one place to make sure that patients could have safe access while the necessary controls to prevent abuse of the system would be in place. So some of those include requiring patients to get a doctor's recommendation and then register with the state. The state then has to verify that those doctor's recommendations come from doctors that are licensed. The doctors have to do a full clinical checkup and follow other rules to make sure they have a relationship with that patient. If they don't do that, the doctor can face sanctions and lose their license. So we don't see those controls in California, for instance, where a previous speaker said that it's one study found that a big portion of the patients are young males and suggest that they don't have legitimate need. The fact is there's no state controls in California verifying those recommendations. We also require real-time seed-to-sale tracking so that every purchase that goes out the door is measured in real time. So it's not possible for a patient to go to several dispensaries and buy more than they're allowed to have. We're so serious about preventing diversion that we created a new felony for anyone who diverts the medicine for profit. So right now, under the current regime, you're looking at a civil a fine of $100, not a criminal offense if you have an ounce of marijuana or less. But if you go to a dispensary and resell that, you're looking at serious jail time. So, well, prison time, actually. It's a felony. So that's another control that we put in place specifically to respond to these kind of concerns. I think the biggest difference between what's going to happen here in Massachusetts and what we see in other states is the controls at the state level. Again, for instance, California, no state regulation. Colorado, much less as well. So overnight, some of those cities saw hundreds of dispensaries open. You go down to Venice Beach in LA, there's hundreds, it's not well regulated. In Denver, hundreds of dispensaries as well overnight. So no wonder that regulators are then concerned about how they're supposed to monitor these things. So that's why in Massachusetts, there's going to be no more than one per county for the foreseeable future. So all eyes are going to be on these dispensaries, ensuring that they do have a positive effect on the community. And that's what we've seen. That's what the data shows when we look at other states. I don't want to bore you with studies. I will send this information to you. I think I have one shy of the amount of copies I need, so forgive me for that. But a 2010 study, LAPD found that dispensaries are no more likely to get robbed than banks. They do not attract crime. 2012 UCLA study found dispensaries do not attract crime. 2014 study by University of Colorado found that dispensaries have the same impact on neighborhoods as coffee shops and that residents do not perceive them to be undesirable. Youth rates of use, the data is very clear there. There are several studies that show dispensaries do not increase youth rates of use. So I know we have limited time. I'm just going to finish up with a few comments. One final one is that in Colorado, it's true that some communities could opt out of having a dispensary there. Interestingly, some of those that did, Fort Collins and Aurora, next to big population centers, they've backtracked now. They've seen how dispensaries increase public safety and economic development, and now they're welcoming the dispensaries, and that's what we're going to see here. Haverhill residents do support this. That's why we turned in those petitions. I also want to draw your attention to a letter from Salem City Councilor Josh Turiel, who voices his support and why they decided to have one dispensary in Salem. You know, we've been, one last statement is just that in this capacity, I've been to local hearings in Boston, Salem, Worcester, Springfield, Brockton, pretty much all over the place. And there is it's just not true that Haverhill's been targeted as going through a different process than other localities have. In each municipality, there have been hearings just like you're having here, and concerns have come up. They've been addressed, and as people got more information, they've decided to move forward and welcome the dispensaries in order to help patients, and I hope that's what the decision is here as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Would the next speaker like to come up to the mic and name and address for the record?
Hi, my name is Harold Altvader. I live on 106 Lowell Road in North Reading, Massachusetts. My profession is that of an anesthesiologist, and I've also been practicing cannabinoid medicine now for about the last 2 years. Since about 2012, I've been engaged with that topic and learning about the subject and advising patients. I just wanted to tell you a little bit about my background and why I think I'm a little bit more have a unique perspective as opposed to other people that may have addressed this group. I've worked in direct patient care since about 1979 as a med tech in the Air Force, and then I went to nursing school, worked as a critical care registered nurse for several years. Then I eventually went to medical school and completed the anesthesia program down at University of Florida. I've practiced throughout in Florida and in Massachusetts, and in fact from the years 2005 to 2011 I was a member of the staff at Merrimack Valley Hospital. At one point I was the chief until we took it over as an individual group for four providers. So I've been in your community. I've been taking care of several of the people in the community here as an anesthesiologist. I've also, unlike other physicians, I've actually giving the drugs as a nurse and giving them as an anesthesiologist. It's one-on-one care. You see how people react to things, and you talk to them before the surgery, after the surgery, and you really have an appreciation when a substance is dangerous and when one that perhaps gives you more leeway, both physiologically and psychologically. when I look at cannabis and I hear that some of the arguments here, it's a little surprising to me. There's an implication that because of a recommendation of a subcommittee of mayors feel that it should be a public debate and a public vote, that somehow because that recommendation wasn't heeded, there's some kind of impropriety. No, you give me a recommendation. If I don't do it, I choose not to do it. There's not impropriety in my mind. If I look at the numbers of people, and now because people have voted for medical cannabis in the state, at a number of about 63%, and locally in Haverhill, let me remind you that there are only 9,500 people that voted against medical cannabis, whereas close to 6,689 voted for it. So that's about a 64%. So even more people in this community voted for it. And the idea that people would vote for something that vote is separate now from having a dispensary and not in my backyard, again, doesn't really hit me that hard. But I just, one thing I am familiar with and that you're not familiar with, because I keep, now I'm hearing that, well, if there's a dispensary in Salem and there's a dispensary in Lowell, everything's going to be fine. Well, let me tell you, there's none serving the major population center in this state. I'm sorry, I misspoke. 16,689 were for medical cannabis in this state. The Salem's going to be saturated by Boston's population. Right now, there's over 16,000 people certified for medical cannabis in this state. There's not a single store open up yet. And the idea that just because you have two stores that that population is going to be met if they're operational, and I have little faith that anybody's meeting their timelines. The DPH, the dispensaries, no one seems to be meeting it. And I want to give you a patient's perspective. Here's what I see. So if you want to become a patient in this state, first thing you have to do, people feel obligated, is that they have to get permission from their local doctor. So when they talk to their local doctor, the local doctor not having any experience in this, given that none of the medical schools in the United States even teach about the endocannabinoid system at all. It's virtually unknown. They certainly haven't done any training on it, and if they have, they've seen it only in the form of a addictive substance. And in fact, the majority of people that purport either unbiased view on cannabis have either worked at institutions that receive funding from National Institutes of Drug Abuse or have received funding in one form or another by that. So they have skin in the game, but the skin's on the other side of the game because there's a lot of conversations about money and profit here. So first you have to get your doctor to prove it, but a lot of patients fear that they're going to alienate or disappoint their providers because they want something that perhaps that physician doesn't want them to have. So, and in fact, I've had some patients that have been dismissed by their physicians, psychiatrists, pain physicians, and internal medicine physicians, because they obtained certification for medical cannabis to treat a condition that was unmet, not being managed in a way that was satisfactory for that patient, so they're discharged from the further care from that provider. So when you see a physician for medical cannabis, you have to pay out of pocket. So that ranges from about $200 to $250 expense for the initial visit, and then subsequent visits are also cash. There's no way right now in the state of Massachusetts that you can find out as a patient which physicians are certified or allowed to take care of you legally. The DPH won't even release that data to patients. So if you see a physician and he writes you a recommendation for cannabis or implies that they're going to, there's even no protection there. So that's another obstacle that a patient has to go to. Well, let's say they happen to see somebody that is registered, like myself. Then they're evaluated. If they meet the criteria, then I let the state know that this person can be a medical cannabis. That involves me putting them into a computer system called the virtual gateway system. And then the patient themselves has to go and register into the virtual gateway system. This is about a 45-minute process, very, very drawn out. They go through that, and anywhere from 1 month to 4 months, they're eventually given, or the medical cannabis card that they paid for is issued to them. And by the way, the DPH provided patients with these cards with three different types of expirations. We're only 5 months into this since they've been doing it. Some of them expire at 1 month, expire at 1 year, some expire at 3 years, and some expire at 2 years. So the oversight by a government agency probably isn't as high as people feel that standard's being met, and would assume that private companies should be more involved or more rigorous. Once they get the medical cannabis card, what can they do? What can members of your community do that are patients? How are they going to get the cannabis? Well, they can grow their own. Unfortunately, farming's agricultural and knowledge in America is just not as much as it used to be. So most people aren't successful with trying to grow their own. There's a problem getting access to seeds because that's illegal. That's a federal felony. Although the state has, in fact, said that it's okay for companies to come in and break federal law by bringing seeds from out of state into Massachusetts. But that's another topic. So then they can grow their own, or they can find a caregiver. So that's someone that would have the ability to provide them with cannabis that's grown at their house, maybe, perhaps. The trouble with that is although the ballot initiative was passed and there were no restrictions on how many folks that a caregiver could provide, the state then subsequently regulated it that he can only serve one patient. So that limits your choice there. So that pool is shrunken. So where do you go? Well, you go to the black market. And black market's not that far away anymore. All you got to do is go on Google. What if you just give me two more minutes, because when I reviewed for this, your protocol said it was 30 minutes aside. And
not the case, but
no.
We'll give you...
That's what's online.
We'll give you... just wrap up quick.
2 minutes. So if you're a patient and you're looking for cannabis, and I'll give you my best one. So you go on, and these are postings from Craigslist. You can find them any day. You just search for the term MMJ. So it says, "Hello, buddy, and my fellow stuffs out there. No cops or any sort of law enforcement involved. Just help the needy. Without a script and insurance, you're 100% protected. Fast, discreet delivery. We deal with high-quality stuff, not some bleep stuff. Confirm goodies before I get the cash. Send text if you're interested. You want that guy coming to your house? Well, guess what? If you don't want him coming to your house for marijuana, here's what else the same person will offer. Oh, I offer Roxy's, Roxaset, Roxycodone, Adderall, Addies, Xanax, Xannies, Narco, Suboxone, Oxycodone, Heroin, Molly, Ambien, Percocet, Ketamine. This is what's out there. So instead of having a safe facility where patients can go to and get access to medicine in their community with their illnesses, you're forcing them to go into this marketplace. I certainly have more, but that's it for now.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And the third speaker.
Hi, how are you? My name is Dr. Dan McGraw, and thank you for hosting this meeting. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, for hearing on this, and President. Thank you, Shannon, for being here from HCTV. She helps me on my show at HCTV called Perspectives. My academic background is a bachelor's in theology and psychology from the University of Notre Dame. I have a master's in counseling from Boston University and a doctorate in education and human services from Boston University. I've practiced as a clinician for 35 years and for 25 years here in Haverhill. I was the HMO mental health case manager for Pawtucket Medical from 1990 to 1998, in which role I evaluated all mental health and substance abuse needs, referrals for treatment, admissions to hospitals, and discharge plans. I've continued in that role of counseling in this field since I left Pawtucket Medical in 1998 in my own private practice. Want to transition quickly to the wonderful things that the City Council has done, the mayor under his tenure has done here. I've seen a lot of improvements from when I came to the Valley in 1990. I was living in Newburyport at the time when I first started working at Pawtucket, and Amesbury was quite depressed socioeconomically, and Haverhill certainly was. I remember the Wingate, you could buy a condominium for $35,000 back in those days. Certainly, with the help of Congresswoman Tsongas, Chairman of the House Ways and Means Committee, Brian Dempsey, and some of the other reps from Haverhill, with you working with them, we've seen incredible changes in downtown Haverhill. I'm from Ward 1. I lived on Portland Street. I lived in the crack house area of Haverhill for 3 years. I know the acre very well. When I was at Pentucket Medical, the assistant in the mental health coordinator office was raised on the acre. She knows Andre Dubois, who wrote Townie. She knows the people. She was that person. She grew up on the acre. So I have firsthand experience here. I'm currently living at 11 Villa Street, near Smith Mercedes Motors, but still in Ward 1 and still in Chairman Dempsey's district. I currently run a TV show, as I said earlier, and I have had a guest where people have raised law enforcement questions. I have had Jack Cole, who is the co-founder of Law Enforcement Against Prohibition, on 3 separate times. I've had a gentleman named Andrew Barron's father, who started an organization called Christians Against Prohibition, on my television show on Perspectives. Jack Cole was in undercover, a state trooper for 14 years in New Jersey. He arrested and put in jail many people for drug uses, and now he is supporting the legalization of marijuana. He said what prohibition has done with drugs is what prohibition did with alcohol in the 20s and early 30s. We repealed that amendment in the 1930s, and yet we're doing that same experiment again, and we know the devastation to society from such restrictions. I don't know why we are repeating that experiment. Now we'd have data that shows actually crime is decreased when when marijuana is legalized, and we have that coming up in 2016. Right now we're looking at medical marijuana, people with cancer, people with glaucoma, people with seizure disorders who can't get their medicine. We can go to the pharmacy and we can get oxycodone, we can get Percodan, we can get Percocet, we can get Xanax, we can get any addictive substance that we want. And by addictive, I mean drugs that increase physical tolerance. You need more and more and more of that drug to have the same effect. Not true with marijuana. It doesn't build physical tolerance. It's been said that marijuana is the gateway drug. I would disagree with that. The physician who spoke on Frank Novak's program, Point of Reference, said that he's worried it's going to lead to more heroin overdoses. I think the gateway drug is alcohol and cigarettes. The rite of passage from childhood to adulthood, is cigarettes and alcohol, coffee. It's not marijuana. When we're children, we're looking at people who drink and we're wondering, when can we smoke? When can we drink? When can we drive a car? Not when can we smoke marijuana. Mr. Novak brought up the question of marijuana in pill form. It's my understanding that there's one pill available at this point. It's high in THC. It's not high in the other cannabinoids, which have medical efficacy. And that pipeline through the FDA is pretty far down the road.
How are we looking for time?
Okay, I'm almost done. Medical marijuana has been shown repeatedly in double-blind scientific studies to be helpful for a various number of medical problems. This question of addiction, oh, if we have medical marijuana available, it's going to increase marijuana use. Well, by that argument, we should not allow the pharmacies to distribute Vicodin, Percocet, Oxycontin, Xanax. It's a false analogy and it's a straw man argument. Thank you for your time, and I hope you will make medical marijuana easily accessible to people with serious medical conditions here in Haverhill and not make them drive, when they are sick, 20 miles to the nearest medical dispensary. This is a humanistic issue. It should bring up forth our humanity, not our fear. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I want to thank all six speakers.
I don't wish to speak. I just want to let the council know that there are more Haverhill residents who are patients here tonight in support.
Okay. Thank
you. So I realize.
Thank you, because you're actually speaking out of order.
Okay.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, next item, which is the mayor's letter.
Order authorized mayor to execute and send letter to Mass Department of Public Health relative to a request by Healthy Farms LLC to amend its registration to change the location of a proposed medical marijuana dispensary / cultivation site from Hale Street to a new location on Research Drive, and also authorized mayor to establish a medical marijuana host agreement committee to assist in negotiation of a host agreement with Healthy Farms LLC.
Mr. Mayor.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. Very good job. Wish I did as good a job chairing the school committee. I had some woman, I gave her 6 minutes to speak. After 45 minutes, I tried to gavel her, and she just kept going. But in any event, let me start by saying that those of you who attended the hunking groundbreaking today, thank you very much. This is truly a great day for our city. I'm here tonight to keep a promise. Months ago, I told you that if there were more letters to be sent out concerning a medical marijuana facility, that I would involve the council, that I would do it publicly, and we would have and continue to have an open, public, and transparent process. I want to review with you the process that's occurred so far. This has been before the council several times already for an open and public and transparent process. At my request, the council voted to have a long moratorium, as long as the Attorney General, then Attorney General of the state, allowed on medical marijuana facilities in the city of Haverhill. We had an open and public process on where the zoning should be. We set up a zoning committee. Councilor Ryan was your representative on the committee. He attended every meeting, and every single meeting was publicly advertised, to my knowledge at least, publicly posted. The public was invited to every meeting, and indeed, several people came. On that open and public and transparent committee, we had Dr. Kyle Rosenblum, the chairman of the Board of Health. We had the police chief. We had the economic development director. We had a city councilor. And I can't honestly remember if anybody else was on it or not. But that committee made its recommendations public and came before the council with the recommendations that we establish a zone for a medical marijuana dispensary, and that we locate it in the Hale Street area. Now, the council did its due diligence and went out and looked at the zone and heard from residents, one of whom's here tonight, or was here, there he is, Michael Schroth, and who supported it, by the way. But the council decided to relocate it to a different area, up to the Route 97 area. I understood that, and I signed it. And we'll continue to do what we have done, which is to have open and public hearings on this. Now, as you know, a group called Healthy Farms has received a license from the state to operate a medical marijuana facility in Haverhill. Their license is for the Hale Street area. The council has already decided not to allow that, but to rezone it. Healthy Farms asked me some time ago, they asked to change their registration with the Department of Public Health from the Hale Street location to the new location at the Broadway Industrial Park. They asked me for some time to sign a letter saying the city does not object to that change, going from Hale Street to the Broadway Park area. And my initial thought, frankly, was that it's self-apparent. If this is the area where they're zoned, why would we object
just saying that this is the area we don't object to, if one is going to go in, to going to that area. But I decided to put it on the agenda. Now, these letters of non-opposition have not been controversial in other cities, at least not to my knowledge. I haven't studied every city. The mayor of Amesbury signed without any public input. We've had more public input in Haverhill than there has been in most other communities. He signed a letter of opposition. It went, and Amesbury has a growing facility that's going in today. They have a host agreement that they're negotiating. The mayor of Quincy, Mayor Koch, signed a letter of non-opposition. And again, to my knowledge at least, it was a non-controversial item. The mayor of Salem, Mayor Driscoll, signed a letter of non-opposition. It went in, and the first facilities will probably open in Salem. The mayor of Boston, who has a lot more clout than I do, Mayor Marty Walsh, said that he was not going to have a medical marijuana facility in his community, but he's getting two of them in any event. He declined to sign the agreement. Healthy Farms has also offered to negotiate with us what's called a host agreement. A host agreement would be similar to the host agreement we have right now today with Covanta, which would, host agreements provide such things as how much will you pay in lieu of taxes, will you give extra money to the city. It's not something that you can do legally along at the time that you do a special permit. That has to be done beforehand. Do we want a host agreement that adds additional police officers to our force, something that they've offered? Do we want a host agreement that provides for an additional full-time drug counselor? Because it's no question that we have, as most communities do, in fact, as all communities do, a drug problem here in the city of Haverhill. Their door is open, but we have to walk through it. I'm told by legal counsel that city councilors cannot be on the host agreement committee, but it is my suggestion that we have a host agreement committee, and I welcome councilors to contact me and tell me what you think should be in the agreement. If we have a host agreement, if you authorize me to go forward tonight, the number one thing that I want in the host agreement is an agreement that if recreational marijuana is allowed in the city of Haverhill, that it will not be here, at least not unless a council and a future mayor, because I won't agree to allow it to be here. The opposition has persuaded me that we do not, Dr. Maddox has persuaded me, that we do not want recreational marijuana here in the city of Haverhill. The Healthy Farms people have agreed that if there's a host agreement, that host agreement will provide, and I have an agreement that they're prepared to sign tonight, that I'm prepared to sign tonight, stating that in the event that they open a medical marijuana facility here, that will not be used to sell recreational marijuana unless a mayor and a city council allow it. And again, I will not agree to that. Now, there have been a number of questions that have been asked. Someone asked, why would we want to be first? Councilor Masick asked that question, and I agree with you. We don't, and we won't. There'll be a facility opening in Salem, Massachusetts, fairly shortly. They'll be the first to open, and there will be others open. And before you have an opportunity to vote on a special permit, you will have an opportunity to see how that's worked out. A number of people have asked me what will happen if we do nothing tonight, or if you vote not to send a letter. If you do nothing tonight, I will send a letter. I've made that clear. If you say do not send the letter, if you vote affirmatively against it, I will not send the letter. I have the authority as mayor to do that, but I will not do that. I indicated previously I defer to your judgment, and I will do that. I'm going to ask the city solicitor to speak on what happens if we do nothing, but the bottom line is there are a number of possibilities. None of us know for certain what will happen. There are a number of possibilities, and some of them aren't very good. The worst case scenario, and the one that I want to avoid at all costs, is that we get a medical marijuana facility anyway. The Baker administration has indicated they're going to have a more market rate approach, not a local control approach, that we get one anyway, but we don't have a host agreement. That's what we want to avoid at all costs. I don't know exactly how this whole medical marijuana issue is going to work out. I know a couple of things. The first is that the voters of the state did vote for it. The voters of the city did vote for it. And the other thing that I'm fairly confident of is that this issue is not going to go away, no matter what we do tonight or on any other night. The Baker administration has taken the position that this should be a market-based approach, not a local option approach. I don't know exactly what this means, but I do know that medical marijuana facilities are going to open up in the state no matter what we do or how we do it. We simply cannot avoid it. I leave you with the words of Boston Mayor Marty Walsh, who refused to sign any letters, refused to negotiate, refused to sign a letter of non-opposition. Two were opening in his city, and he indicated at that time, he said, you know, we may not like it, but you just can't fight these things because they're going to go somewhere, and that's the way it is. If you have any other questions, the legal questions should go to Bill Cox. He's here tonight. I've also hired outside counsel from Copelman and Page to negotiate, if you authorize me to do a host agreement, to negotiate the host agreement.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. Would the city solicitor like to brief us on the options and what the impact would
Thank
be?
You. For the record, Bill Cox, city solicitor. So the bottom line is that we don't really know with regards to some of these things, unfortunately. There's several possibilities, and some of them I would suggest are not necessarily advantageous. The first is that Healthy Farms could locate to another community nearby, and in that case, then we get some of the negative impact of that with none of the benefit of having a host agreement. The second thing that could happen is that they can appeal to DPH, ultimately to the courts. They may want their application considered without a letter. I did have some conversation today with Deputy Legal Counsel at DPH as to what would happen if they were not able to provide a letter to DPH, and I was told that they would evaluate the situation, which tells me that they would most likely take into consideration the facts and circumstances under which they were not able to get it, and then they would probably move forward from there. So that's some of the information that I have, but I'm glad and happy to answer any other questions that the council may have.
I don't think we have any more questions. Councilor Daley O'Brien and Vice President Scaramaccia,
have a question.
You have the floor.
Thank you. When you say there'd be a negative impact on Haverhill if the marijuana facility was to locate in a neighboring community, I'm not sure if I follow you.
Well,
what would be the negative impact of it on our city?
Right. So if there's a negative impact on our city, as some people have suggested, the crime and other potential impacts, which we would attempt to mitigate by way of the host agreement. So if they decided to set up shop in, let's say, Methuen, up the road on 97 somewhere, then, you know, they're really only a couple of miles away from where the city has designated the area to be. So in that case, that's what I meant. They would then locate there. We would have no host agreement with them. I would assume that Methuen would have a host agreement with them, and then they would then, but we would still be dealing with the ramifications of that facility being there.
Is it possible that we could have a different company want to set up a marijuana dispensary? Is that possible, or is this the only game we got?
Well, I mean, I don't know that I'm in a position to answer that. I would just say that, you know, that they have filed their registration with the state, and that they have been approved, as you're aware, mm-hmm. to a certain point in this process. The issue, I think, as the mayor pretty succinctly put it, is that, you know, we came into this with no zoning, and the advice that we had at that time was that if we don't have zoning, then they can locate anywhere. And we didn't want to be in that situation, as quite frankly, most other communities, whether they're have been suggested as a site for a medical marijuana dispensary or not, most other cities and towns in the Commonwealth have gone through and provided zoning provisions for the location of these facilities. What has happened, my understanding, is that we, in talking with the Deputy Legal Counsel at DPH, is that we have passed our zoning ordinance, we've provided a location, they have secured a site within that location, and that they have now petitioning DPH to change the location. They had originally proposed Hale Street when there was no zoning, and that was a viable site. And now that there is zoning, they're proposing a site that's within that zone.
So, in other words, we did not solicit having a marijuana facility in Haverhill. They chose us. They chose a place. But then we passed a zoning. Is that true? We did not solicit their business.
No, no.
They came here.
Correct.
They found a place.
Right.
And then because we wanted to control that, we went through the zoning process.
Right.
Because I don't want people to think that we, the city, solicited this. They chose us.
Right.
They found a place, and that set the motion. Okay.
I think it's fair to say that when we became aware that they had some interest in the city, it heightened the need to address the issue of the zoning.
Totally agree.
And we were able to extend that more or less to the end of the period which the then Attorney General was allowing cities and towns to have a moratorium so that they could look at this issue, review it, consider potential sites within the community as this council did. You considered many sites and you settled on one that you felt was best. So we worked within that process. We used virtually all the time we were allowed to do that. And I think the council spent a significant amount of time reviewing those sites. So we came up with this one site, and now what DPH is asking, more or less, is it zoned correctly, and is there opposition to the location within that zone? The mayor's letter, as you have it, says there is not opposition within that zone because that's where it's been zoned. Proviso, though, that's also included in that letter is that they have to get a special permit from the city council, and they also have to get a license from the Board of Health, because the Board of Health has legal authority, and they've done that, has enacted a set of regulations with regards to the siting of these facilities as well. So we've also added that layer of protection.
Mm-hmm. Actually, I have a question or two for the mayor. Would that be possible?
Yes.
I just want to say, Mr. Mayor, that I'm really happy that you put this in a public light, because I think that's really going to help clarify things. I hope it does. Do you really need our authorization to do any of this?
Nope.
I mean, you really don't.
I want to, okay.
What I see, though.
Counselor, if you don't mind, could you make a motion just to put it on the table? For this particular order.
Oh, okay.
And start asking
those
questions, if you could.
Oh, all right. I'd like to make a motion that we authorize the mayor to execute a letter to the Department of Public Health.
And there's a motion by Councilor Daley O'Brien. Is there a second?
I'll second it for discussion, Mr. President, but I have some comments.
Second by Vice President Scaramaccia, and I apologize
for that awkward
moment.
That's all right.
I didn't realize that you're going to get into that line of questioning. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So you really don't need our authorization.
I don't.
And what I'm wondering is if we can split the two things. The execution of the letter and the authorization to establish a medical marijuana host agreement. I'm uncomfortable with them being one document. I think that might be, because in truth, you really don't need our authorization, but I feel differently about the two pieces of
it.
So if we could separate it, I would be more comfortable. I don't know how my fellow councilors feel about it, but I think they're two different things, and That's my suggestion at this point. So at the proper time, that's it.
So the first order is the letter.
Right.
That we're discussing now. We'll have a vote on that.
So I'd really like to make a motion to separate the two issues.
I'd second that.
Okay. There's a motion by Councilor Daley O'Brien, seconded by Councilor Barrett. Actually, these issues, you know, are basically separated already by virtue of the fact that they're two separate orders.
Well, but they're one.
They're one.
They're on the same page.
They
I guess is what
one.
You're saying.
So
okay.
I think
why don't we just have a simple vote to separate the two items?
Yes, thank you.
And there's been a motion and a second. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
This is on separation, Mr. President.
That's only on the separation of the two orders. We'll handle one at a time.
Councilor Scaramaccio.
Yes.
Councilor Barrett.
Yes.
Councilor Masick.
Yes.
Councilor Ryan.
Yes.
Councilor Sullivan.
Yes.
Councilor Daley O'Brien.
Yes.
Councilor LePage.
Yes.
President Mitchell.
Yes.
8 yeas, 0 nays, 1 absent.
Okay, thank you very much. And
I yield the floor to my fellow councilors.
Thank you very much, Councilor. Mr. Vice President.
Thank you, Mr. President. Quite frankly, when I saw this on the agenda, I was a little confused. I don't understand why, and my comments go along with Councilor Daley O'Brien's comments, is, you know, why you're asking us to authorize you to send the letter. You didn't need the letter for the Hale Street, our authorization for the Hale Street project, for the Hale Street site. So it kind of made me wonder why you're here before us tonight. But
there was no letter for the Hale Street site.
I signed the letter. That was the letter I signed. Oh, it was a letter of non-opposition.
No, that wasn't for the Hale Street site. That was in general. I hope I've learned from my mistakes. I said when I came before the council last time that if there was another letter, I would do it as an open and public process, unlike what most of the other mayors have done. I would come before the council and bring it before you and try to reach a joint decision on the letter.
Mr. President, I don't know if this even needs a vote. I just like to receive it and place it on file, the letter, and the mayor can do what he wants with it.
Well, there is a motion on the table, and depending on what the result is of that, we can have a follow-up motion.
What's
so?
We just separated.
Right now, we're going to vote on the order that's on the table.
Mayor, send a letter.
To ask the mayor. Or to approve of the mayor to send the letter.
You know, I don't know why I don't know why he needs our authorization to do it.
He's asked for it.
Right, and that's your opinion. And now let's hear what the other councilors have to say.
Okay,
we'll come back to you.
Okay, fine. Again. I didn't realize there were any of my colleagues wanted to comment, but I certainly will withdraw my motion to receive it.
Thank you. Mr. Vice President. Councilor LePage.
Thank you, Mr. President. To go to what Councilor Scaramaccio said and the mayor, the letter wasn't for Hale Street. The letter was specifically for Healthy Farms. So if the intent was not for an applicant, it was just generic, that was the city's intent, but that's not how it was used by DPH and by the applicant. By the applicant, having that letter, they realized that they would get 15 points out of 163. 9% of their scoring was to that. And when Councilor Scaramaccio signed for no moratorium, which is the letter that he signed it for two companies. It was addressed to two companies. One was Healthy Farms, the other one was Nature's Cure. They're located in Billerica, or that was where their application was for. So Councilor Scaramaccio signed one that was going for Billerica, so he had no knowledge of where they were to go to. So again, when he asked about council permission, it was never really brought to the council. Now that it's been brought to over this past year, I'm appreciative because, as you've said, the council has gone through, going through zoning and went to the administration and finance. We met four times. We've had public hearings. We did all of our due diligence in going on the topic of zoning, protecting what should be Haverhill's decision to make. As Councilor Daley O'Brien said, we didn't solicit. It wasn't like we put out an RFP looking for a business to come here. By what happened in the time frame of our meeting on November 19th of 2013, we extended the moratorium because we didn't have enough information. I asked for that because I didn't think, as a city councilor, that we had enough information. I know I didn't know enough about the law as I was still researching and studying it. The application went in 2 days later. It had to be in by the 21st. So I think the question is of that timeline. So again, you are able to send a letter without our approval, and now you've asked for our approval. But as folks have mentioned, I think this council has also asked, is that there's other applications that could happen. There's other things that could go on. Is it really necessary that the city council is basically make an endorsement for this? That's what the DPH is looking for. They're looking for an endorsement that there's non-opposition or support for a particular applicant, not just in general, because we know that we can't zone it out. We know that that's the law, and that's what's been in case. But what they were looking for was that there be meetings that we're having now that we had concerning zoning, but not particularly to an applicant or an applicant that came in. The gentleman that dropped off the information from Salem, the city councilor, he mentioned that there was two firms and that they both discussed with Salem. So there was a correspondence and there was activity in conversation. It was an open discussion that they had two that they were working with. The city council wasn't knowledgeable of any, and it seems, I'm not sure if the administration was certain of how many companies were coming and could make a proper decision on a piece of paper that they really didn't know the worth of. And I think that's what's happening now, is what's the worth of this letter? It seems to be innocuous, but I don't believe that's how DPH will interpret it. And I'm sorry, Mr. Mayor, so I'll ask, when you mentioned Boston, and you mentioned now that the mayor declined, before that, Boston, the DPH had allowed one there, then the folks in Boston retracted their letter of non-opposition, saying that they weren't told of the location of where it should be, the physical location, so they withdrew that. Now they're going through, and the DPH, I believe, has 20-odd cases against them by other applicants. There was 158 applicants to start. It was whittled down to 100, and then it was down to 20, and they all have scoring. And I think when you're talking about market-based, and that's going to happen from my conversation with the DPH and what's on their website, is May 15 is when they'll put out those regulations. Not knowing what those are, I don't know if you can say now Boston's going to have two. If that's the case, if now they're not going to have a host agreement, I find that hard to fathom, that Boston wouldn't be able to negotiate a host agreement. Now it's just going to be forced on them, and they don't have a choice in the matter. As you said, Marty Walsh seems to be pretty powerful. I think that Boston would be able to negotiate some kind of host agreement. And when you mentioned no recreational marijuana, I don't understand how we could say, if that was the vote of the people in 2 years or later, how we could say no. So I don't know how we would locally be able to do that. So I don't know if you can say that you'd get them to say no recreational marijuana, because the people haven't spoken about that. We can't decide that.
Counselor, did you have a question for the mayor or the city solicitor on the actual impact of the letter?
Well, is that? I think I had a conversation with Councilor Day of the DPH, as I asked her to speak to City Solicitor Cox on that. And as he said, they really didn't say what would happen if there was a letter or if there was not a letter from the council or the mayor.
So okay.
That's
and the city solicitor had said that earlier.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Councilor. Councilor Masick.
Thank you, Mr. President. I believe that the two that are being forced on Boston through a court order is what we risk if we don't play this correctly. I think we're early, very early in the process. I have the same fears that were registered by the people that were speaking against medical marijuana, but I have, I believe, some even greater fears to bury our head or try to slam the door and say, no, not here. Because I think ultimately we will have it forced upon us, if not by Healthy Farms, perhaps by somebody else. Because in the same way as the courts have historically, and there's much case law about how we have to zone properly and we have to allow for legal adult bookstores and, you know, adult
type venues, and we've taken care of that. And in the same way, we made sure that we've taken care of the zoning properly for medical marijuana. And so I think the next step is, whether it be Healthy Farms or whoever has an application in its preliminary stages, that we do our hard work, that we ask the hard questions, that we drill down, make sure we do get all the safeguards, all the public safety protection, and that we negotiate with that company who wants to come here to vend a legal product in the state of Massachusetts, to make sure that we don't have a downside that it go next door. Because I believe there are some downsides if it goes next door. One of them is going to be that, and this is one that just I personally fear, and that would be people that have prescriptions for medical marijuana, because they're totally handicapped and debilitated, that they can't get the product to them, so they apply for a waiver for home grow. And if they get a waiver for home grow, that means they'll be able to actually grow marijuana plants in their home. We don't have the police power to even begin to think about regulating that or overseeing it. And it's something that could be negotiated into a host community agreement. What I would like to see, hopefully, one of the things that goes on the table for the host community agreement is that whoever comes to the city would agree to do full city delivery to every corner of the community, in which case there would be no ability for anybody to get a home grow agreement from DPH. So, because say DPH says, sure, you can grow, and I don't know how they would measure it, two plants, you know, or so much at a time. Who's going to oversee that? Who's going to make sure that they're not carrying on a large hydroponic marijuana growing center in their basement or their attic? You know, it's going to be tough to regulate. It's going to cost a lot of money and police power to try and regulate it, and it's going to become a problem for the community that would probably be almost undoable to properly oversee. If we get the RMD applicant licensee to agree to do delivery, it's not a problem. And it, actually, they would probably also participate in providing the city with revenue to educate, to make sure that we have safeguards. Who pays for this? All the anti-smoking ads that we constantly are hit with in magazines or on the television or radio? Who's paying for that? The cigarette companies are. So in the same kind of backward way, we can probably even negotiate some things that give us additional safeguards against some of the problems that we don't want to see happen in our city by having a good working agreement with the RMD licensing. So, and we're far from, I'm not saying that I even will ever fully support, but I think that we need to at least be smart enough to negotiate in good faith and to try and represent the best interests of our city and its people and its children on every turn. And I think we'll do much better at that if we try to openly work things out than to try and say, no, not here, or we're going to bury our head and we just don't want it. Because I don't believe that will work. I don't think, you know, even if DPH says, and I've heard them say it because I've been on all but one of the conference calls that happened during the day about medical marijuana with different communities being able to dial in. They say, if you don't want it in your community, just tell us. Well, they're not a court of law, and we won't put it there, they'll say. Well, at some point in time, somebody's going to decide Haverhill is a good location, and they want to put it here. And if we say we don't want it, I believe they'll be able to successfully go to court and place it here. So, and I think the case of the two Boston facilities is already proof that that's where the courts will be heading, because they do the same thing with other categories. So with that being said, I think that we, I'm willing to support the order tonight to allow the mayor, and I trust the mayor will always be acting in the best interest of the city, and I would like to see him have that opportunity, and I support that opportunity. I also want to say that I think that the first request deals only with location, and that it's clear that he's not supporting the facility in any other way, shape, or form, except to put it in the zone that we said it should be in. And I believe that's what it accomplishes and nothing more. Thank you.
Thank you, Counselor. Mr. Vice President.
Thank you, Mr. President. You know, once again, I'm just going to reiterate my previous comments that what you're asking us, Mayor, is to do something you do every day, send letters. You're also asking us to authorize you to create a committee. You do that quite often. Anytime you feel that there's a committee that needs to be formed and established, you do that. I just don't understand why all of a sudden, you know, it's so important that this comes to the council when we were talking about the Hale Street project, the Hale Street site. You know, it wasn't that important, it seems. And certainly, we want to do what's right for the city. We want to make sure that its citizens are represented on both sides. Quite frankly, I really have no problem with a medical marijuana dispensary. But I just don't understand why this is here when this is something you could do on your own. I'm not, you know, I'll support certain, I don't even know why you're asking us to authorize you to establish a committee. You formed committees before. You've done it. You had a parking committee. You had zoning committees. You have all kinds of things, and you never came to us for that. You may you know, if it's just, you know, it's just something that, you know, unless you can come up with a better explanation as to why this is here tonight, you know, I'm not going to support this. I'm not going to support the letter. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Vice President. Mr. Mayor.
Well, very simple, because when I did it on my own before, I was roundly criticized that said that we should have had a more open and public process. That's why I'm here tonight, to avoid that criticism. And can't have it both ways. You know, when you signed the letter last time, there was an awful lot of criticism of both of us saying there should have been an open public process. It should have been more transparent. We heard that from people here tonight. And if the council wants me to send the letter, I'll send the letter. If you decide to do nothing and say, Mayor, this is within your authority, I'll send it. That's fine. But if the council says no, we've had a public hearing, you've heard from everybody, then I won't send it. That's what the council said they wanted. Transparency, you've got it.
No, you can't have it both ways either, Mayor. What the letter I signed, I was told that this was only going to extend the moratorium so that we could study this further. There was no transparency. If you had asked, I don't know why you didn't sign it. You were in your office.
You and I never spoke. You spoke to David Van Dam. You never spoke to me. The letter I thought was pretty apparent what it said. It did say it was going to extend the thing, but it also said the city had no objection to establishing a medical marijuana zone here in the city of Haverhill. That's what it said. It was clear. It was obvious. I should have signed it. You're right. I decided at the time it was a council matter, so I deferred to you as council president. You indicated later you shouldn't have signed it, and I took the rap for that.
Well, I shouldn't have signed it. I should have at least had an explanation as to what it was, and it should have come before the council if it was so important.
But wait a minute. The letter today is coming before the council. That's what you said you wanted, and that's what I'm
doing. It was the original letter. I don't want to get into history.
Okay.
But my point is I don't know why we just don't accept this and place it on file and let the mayor do what he wants to do with
well,
it.
Well, there's a motion already on the table to vote on it. You can abstain. That would certainly voice your opinion.
We move the vote.
And we're going to move the vote when councilors have finished speaking, which hopefully will be very soon.
I'm done.
Thank you, Mr. Vice President, and thank you, Mr. Mayor. So I'm against the letter, approving the letter. It's been a backdoor process, an insider game since day one. Why should a letter of non-opposition from a city official be worth points to an applicant? Who would know that other than the insiders? Why should this letter of non-opposition from a mayor be required at this point? Because it perpetuates the back door. We are being backed into this. I don't trust the process, and I don't want to contribute to it. Madam Clerk, Please call the roll.
Councilor Scatamucci.
Before you do, there was a light that just went on, Madam Clerk, if you wouldn't
could
mind
I just make a
holding back.
Comment, Mr. President, on just for clarification.
Yes.
The order says that the city does not object to this change in location. I do not see anything in here that says that there is non-opposition in the first paragraph of the order that we've split, that we're voting on first. I don't believe that this is for a letter that gives non-opposition. I believe it is only for the location change.
For no objection to that.
To location change. Putting it where
good.
We zoned it.
I'm good with that.
Okay, but you...
But my comment still stands about why is this letter being required, coming from the mayor.
But I'm voting on an order that, to me, I just want to clarify then for the public and the people that are listening, that this order says it is only for support of the change of location, and that is to a district that we have zoned as an overlay district for medical marijuana RMDs.
So, Councillor, let me just read the letter. Our non-opposition at this time is wholly contingent upon Healthy Farms seeking and obtaining approval. Our non-opposition at this time.
The letter, I'm not voting on the letter, Mr. President. I'm voting on the order. I can't control what he writes in his letter. The letter, to me, does not reflect what the order says.
Well, I don't support the letter, so.
All right, well, then why don't we discuss that? At least make that clear to the mayor that the letter should reflect what the order reflects, as I support that, and nothing more.
Are you asking the question to the mayor?
No, I'm asking
you
to
clarify it.
Making a motion?
I can't. There's already a motion on the floor to be
There's voted. Already a motion on the floor. The order is to support the letter, right?
No, the order doesn't support the letter. The order is to tell the mayor that he's authorized to execute and send the attached letter. Yeah.
So why would you authorize him to do that if you didn't support the letter?
You're right. I'm not going to support the order because I don't believe that the letter reflects what the intention of the order is. Thank you.
Thank you very much,
Thank you for
Counselor.
The opportunity to discuss that.
Thank you. Councilor LePage.
Thank you, Mr. President. I just also wanted to clarify, we split the order, so which are we voting on, the first paragraph?
Just the first one.
Okay.
The letter itself, not the committee.
Okay.
Then we'll have the pleasure of voting on the second one. When we're done with the first.
And I'm sorry, and I appreciate your conversation with Councilor Masick, but just it is the letter that's here. And if I may add, again, I think the presence of a letter by DPH regulations is what matters. They also have language in the letter. Now, I'm not sure what the language was for the first letter, if it was the same. They have a template that they ask it to be. But I'm not sure if just, again, the presence of a letter means what you might think is just non-opposition or a change of location. I think it could possibly mean much more than that. And again, I think the city solicitor mentioned as far as what that would mean to DPH is the presence of a letter or not. I can't determine exactly what words are meant. I believe the letter that was done the first time we were told was innocuous. That was the intent of it. But it seemed to matter much more. So I just wanted to clarify that also. But again, we're voting on the first item and then the second. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Oh, Mr. President.
Mr. Mayor.
This is the letter. It's this letter or no letter.
Yes.
And that's not my choice. DPH has indicated.
The wording.
Yeah, this is the wording. Okay. Same thing with last time. You're right. Everybody should have been told that the earlier letter, which Councilor Scatamucci assigned, got points. Nobody knew that. DPH didn't make that clear.
I mean, why would you give points for a letter of non-opposition?
What a strong
recommendation for points that is.
I agree, but that's nothing we did as a city. That's DPH.
I understand.
Thanks.
I understand, Mayor.
Mr. Jujuga didn't know that gave the city points, that gave Healthy Farm points.
I don't speak for him.
No, I understand that, Mayor, but I just threw
remind
that
you,
out.
I ran against Jim Jujuga. I don't speak for him.
Madam Clerk, before we end up someplace that we don't want to be, please call the roll.
Councilor Scatamucci.
Abstain.
Councilor Barrett.
No.
Councilor Masick.
No.
Councilor Ryan.
Yes.
Councilor Sullivan.
Yes.
Councilor Daley O'Brien.
No.
Counselor LePage?
No.
President Richardson?
No.
5 noes, 2 yeas, 1 abstain.
And that fails. Is there a motion for the second order?
I'll make a motion.
Madam Clerk, do you want to read that order?
Authorize the mayor to establish a medical marijuana host agreement committee to assist in the negotiation of a host agreement with Healthy Farms LLC.
And is there a motion? Was it Councilor Barrett that made the motion? Is there a second?
Second.
Second from Councilor Ryan. Any discussion? Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Scatamaccia?
Yes.
Councilor Barrett?
Yes.
Councilor Masick?
Yes.
Councilor Ryan?
Yes.
Councilor Sullivan?
Yes.
Councilor Daley O'Brien?
No.
Councilor LePage?
No.
President Richardson?
Yes.
6 yeas, 2 noes, 1 absence.
And that passes. Madam Clerk, next item.
Okay.
Back to 8.
Applications.
Applications, handicap parking signs. Brian D. Waters for 84 Blossom Street, Aldegracia Aquino for 49 Bellevue Street, and Karen Susi for 30 Lancaster Street. These should be sent to planning for ordinances.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Councilor Daley O'Brien, seconded by Councilor Barrett. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? That passes. Next item.
Application for permit. Application from American Diabetes Association for 2015 North Shore Tour de Cure Recycling Event, May 17th, 7 a.m. to 3 p.m., beginning in Tops Field and continuing through several city streets.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Councilor Daley O'Brien, seconded by Councilor Masick. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? That passes. Next item.
Application from Greater Haverhill Chamber of Commerce, retroactive approval for event vendor permit for food and toy vendors for Kids Art Fest, Saturday, May 2nd, 11 to 4 p.m.
Move the application.
Second.
Motion by Councilor Daley O'Brien, seconded by Councilor Masick. Councilor Barrett.
Just as a clarification, this was just fell through the cracks.
Yes.
Yeah. But all their other paperwork was in
absolutely
a timely manner.
Yep. Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for clarifying that. I'm sure there are some folks out there that really appreciated that, as a matter of fact. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Scatamaccia?
Yes.
Councilor Barrett?
Yes.
Councilor Masick?
Yes.
Councilor Ryan?
Yes.
Councilor Sullivan?
Yes.
Councilor Daley O'Brien?
Yes.
Councilor LePage?
Yes.
President Richardson?
Yes.
8 yeas, 0 nays, 1 absent.
That passes. Next item.
Junk dealer, TJS Metals, 43 Hale Street.
Move the license be granted.
Second.
Motion by Councilor Masick, seconded by Councilor Daley O'Brien. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? That passes. Next item.
Hawker Peddler, Christopher O'Brien, to sell hot dogs, chips, soda, and candy at Winnikinney area, Route 110, 12 months, Sunday through Saturday, 9 a.m. to 9 p.m.
Move the application.
Second.
Motion by Councilor Daley O'Brien, seconded by Councilor Barrett. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? That passes.
Drain layer 2015 license, J. Alexa, a renewal.
Move the application.
Second.
Motion by Councilor Daley O'Brien, seconded by Councilor Barrett. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? That passes.
Hearing document 33, petition from attorney Robert Harp for applicant owner Eileen F. Petricelli, requesting to amend zoning district boundary map for a portion of property located at 95 Lake Street from RR residential rural density zone to the RM residential medium zone, where passage would emplace the entire property of 70.8 acres in an RM zone. Favorable recommendation from planning board director William Pillsbury. Ordinance regarding zoning, Lake Street, RR to RM, filed March 18th, 2015. Related communication from attorney Robert Hard, requesting on behalf of applicant that the hearing be continued to June 16th, 2015.
Attorney Harb is here, and how are you feeling?
We're doing fine, and I think I bought some stock in some water company since I've been here last time.
Don't worry, I'm ready if you need me.
Thank you. Everybody says to me, I'm very lucky to have my private nurse, and I appreciate that. I feel like y'all would use. I did file a request for a continuance. Although this was an order, the applicant, due to some circumstances, isn't able to be here, and we both thought that would be very important to the council. The zoning change only affects her property itself. There's no other properties involved in the chain. I worked with the clerk to pick another convenient date for everyone, and June 16th was the date, so I'd ask you to please continue it to 16th. Our original petition did waive the 65-day hearing requirement.
Move the request.
Second.
Thank you, Attorney. A motion by Council Ryan, seconded by Council Barrett. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Council Scatamaccio.
Yes.
Council Barrett.
Yes.
Council Masick.
Yes.
Council Ryan.
Yes.
Council Sullivan.
Yes.
Council Daly O'Brien.
Yes.
Council LePage.
Yes.
President Mitchell.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
8 yeas, 0 nays, 1 absent.
See you in June.
That passes. I think the warmer weather will be better for him, don't you think, Counselor?
A little color. He'll get a little more color. Right in the middle of budget. Exciting.
Madam Clerk, next item.
Order. City Council authorizes purchasing department to proceed with final disposition of list of obsolete equipment for purchasing and police departments.
Move for passage of the order.
Second.
Motion by Councilor Masick, seconded by Councilor Barrett. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Council Scatamaccio.
Yes.
Council Barrett.
Yes.
Council Masick.
Yes.
Council Ryan.
Yes.
Council Sullivan.
Yes.
Council Daly O'Brien.
Yes.
Council LePage.
Yes.
President Mitchell.
Yes.
8 yeas, 0 nays, 1 absent.
And that passes. Next item.
Order authorizing payment of bills of the previous year and authorized payment from current year departmental appropriations as listed. J. Bresnahan Company, $1,454 from the school department account. Lyons and Lyon and Rogers, $18.90 school department.
Move for passage of the order.
Second.
Motion by Councilor Masick, seconded by Councilor Barrett. Please call the roll.
Council Scatamaccio.
Yes.
Council Barrett.
Yes.
Council Masick.
Yes.
Council Ryan.
Yes.
Council Sullivan.
Yes.
Council Daly O'Brien.
Yes.
Council LePage.
Yes.
President Mitchell.
Yes.
8 yeas, 0 nays, 1 absent.
That passes. Next item.
Ordinance document 19-BB, ordinance regarding vehicles and traffic, amend chapter 240-101, schedule S, speed regulations, and chapter 240-98, schedule P, heavy commercial vehicles, filed April 22nd, 2015.
Thank you very much. And Mr. Pettis is here to provide the context of this ordinance.
John Pettis, city engineer. So we recently completed a review of the speed regulations and truck exclusions in the city of Haverhill. In doing so and getting all the official documents, we found that the current city code list for both of these items is incomplete. It has their official documents that have been passed that are not on our list. There are some that are on our list that are unofficial. So basically, to be official for a speed regulation, it has to be approved by city council, has to be approved by MassDOT, has to be approved by the Register of Motor Vehicles. And for a truck exclusion, it just needs city council and Mass Highway. So basically, anything other than any document that was approved by all of those is considered unapproved and unenforceable. There are certainly plenty of streets in the city of Haverhill that we don't have regulations for. Basically, you know, those fall under, based on the type of road, like 40 miles per hour in a outside of a thickly settled area, 30 miles per hour in a thickly settled, 20 in a speed zone. So basically, what we have is we have a list of the ones that there are regulations, and I'm just trying to, what the request is to have the city code match the official list.
And what are the implications of this? Are we expecting that some residents may be upset if we go in and change some of the signage that we have now?
I think what we should be doing to do the right thing to follow the law, again, is we should be adopting only the official ones. And then whatever ones we have that are on our list that were unofficial, it would require a study, typically by a traffic engineer. For a new speed regulation or for a truck exclusion.
Thank you very much. Councilor Barrett.
Thank you, Mr. President. That was kind of my question. So if there's a weight restriction on a certain street, say Church Street, and the church that was put in, I believe, because the church couldn't take the vibrations, they would the, should the council bring it forth or the church?
Yes, leaders? You do a request through the mayor's office, and then we would get a study done and send it in. Again, if the state approved it, then they would give us written approval, and then again, we could add it to the city code list.
In that kind of case, it's not an overwhelming, but then in some cases, we won't be able to change things?
There are certainly going to be times that they're going to say no. I mean, I know, like, I think the only truck exclusion request that's been done through me since I've been city engineer was one that was made. There was a request to do one on a dead-end street, and I knew it wasn't going to pass because there's no other way of getting to across a dead end street. You know, there has to be an alternative. Like Church Street obviously has an alternative at South Main Salem Street right next to it.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Councilor. President. Councilor Masick.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. President. John, I've looked through this, and there's quite a number of roads that are going to be affected in one way or the other. Mm-hmm. And I understand what you're saying, and you know, this is something that the state has passed, but just for my own clarification, even on non-numbered state roadways within our city, after we pass this, it's going to cost us $4,000 to $5,000 to get back to where we are now.
Oh, we aren't really anywhere now. They're
well, because they're not legal, is what
they're
you're
not
saying.
Legal. Correct.
Yeah, but
correct. To get to the legal,
but the
to
state
get back.
Has passed legislation now controls even our roadways that are not state roadways.
Yeah, it's not anything new. It's always been that way.
It has.
It is.
But we've never had to. I mean,
we didn't follow it.
Well, I think our system was working just fine, and for a lot less money. I mean, this, I think you said in your letter, you know, we'll have to decide how many we can go at a time. You know, if there's
certainly
any money in the budget at all. I mean, this is going to end up costing us hundreds of thousands of dollars to get our speed limits to where people are familiar with them now, because they're going to revert back, and a lot of them are going to a slower speed, so that could even create additional ripples that people are going to get stopped because they're not going the speed limit, because the speed limit is now 25 miles an hour when they're familiar with it with being 30 or 35. Correct.
Yes. Well, the only thing we can do is make it what's legal and post what's legal, and
yeah,
when you feel it's justified to change it and do so. Now, there are times when the state will do the study rather than us having to go out to a consultant and do it. We recently had a request came in, went to the state for over the area on Canosa next to the entrance of Winnie.
That's
Kenny.
A numbered highway.
Hmm?
That's one of their
it doesn't
roads.
Matter. It's city road right there.
Okay.
But they went and did it. I guess the bad news for those who are hoping they would go drop from 40 to 35 is the speed study came back and said it's consistent with 40 miles an hour being correct.
So because of the magnitude of the changer, we might be able to get some workability in working
yes,
with the state?
Yes, and the state's been very good. The state's been very good through this whole process in helping us get the official list. We couldn't get our hands on some of the documents. We were able to get some of them through the state.
All right. Well, I'm going to support what we legally should be doing, but I also hope that we can work with you and you can work with the state to get us a little bit back to normal without it costing that kind of money per yep. location. Thanks, John.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much, Counselor. What was the driving force to do this now? I'm just curious.
It's basically, we've been doing a lot of, you know, I don't know if some of you are familiar with our GIS mapping system.
Yes.
We've been doing a lot of work in all of our drainage, sewer, water, all those systems onto these base maps. And one of the base maps we wanted to get done was our speed regulations. And when we started going through it, we came to the realization that we had a lot of regulations that weren't official.
Okay, that was very clear. Thank you. Councilor Daley O'Brien.
Oh, thank you, Mr. President. So let me get this straight. Is there a large cost associated with the fact that we're going back to what they were? Or is the large cost going to be associated with they go back to what they were and then we try to change them again?
There should be no cost
going back
and having our code be only what's legal.
Okay.
There'll be costs if there's something that say.
So we can prioritize what we currently. What changes need to be done, and maybe in some cases they won't need to be done, and that will be a bonus.
Right.
And if the state can help us, that will also be a bonus.
Yes.
So I think it will probably come, the onus will come on us to decide what's a priority. And would you bring that to us? If say we go back to a street that's right now 35, 40 miles an hour, mm-hmm. goes back to 25, and it's just not working. Would you bring that to us? Or will we bring that to you?
I think it'd go either way.
Either way,
I think it'd go either way. I think it's who comes to whose attention that, you know, if something's not working, then obviously we need to address it.
All right. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Counselor. Counselor Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. President. John, getting back to Canosa Avenue, so that was my request to Representative Dempsey, and he then contacted MassDOT. They came out and did the study. Unfortunately, they seem to feel 40 miles per hour in front of the entrance is still okay. But there was some good news related to that study. Can you share with us the good piece of that, please?
Yeah. The meeting that this came to light was actually not actually about speed. It was actually about the Route 110, Route 108 intersection.
Mm.
It's something we've been looking to improve. I had a meeting with the state on last Friday about it, and that's when they brought to light about the 40 miles an hour probably staying. However, just Route 110, just after 108, just north of 108, becomes state highway. And because some of the work would involve that area, the state has actually intimated that they're very likely to take on the whole project themselves, including design costs.
And what about sidewalks?
Yeah, and as part of that would be improving the 110, 108 intersection, and it would be likely to be doing sidewalks at least down to the entrance to Winnikinney.
Both sides of the street?
I don't. That's to be determined. But again, by doing sidewalk one or both sides, what that does is narrows down the paved width, so you have a less distance for a crosswalk, makes it a safer.
And what about crosswalk. The pedestrian crosswalk? Did they address the need for improvements to a pedestrian crosswalk?
Yeah, again, that'll all be part of that study. Yeah.
So they will improve pedestrian crosswalk.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Counselor. And is there a motion?
Move for passage.
Second.
Motion by Councilor Masick, seconded by Councilor Daley O'Brien. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Scatamaccia.
Yes.
Councilor Barrett.
Yes.
Councilor Masick.
Yes.
Councilor Ryan.
Yes.
Councilor Sullivan.
Yes.
Councilor Daley O'Brien.
Yes.
Councilor LePage.
Yes.
President Mitchell.
Yes.
8 yeas, 0 nays, 1 absent.
That passes. Thank you, Mr. Pettis.
Thank you.
Next item.
Document 58, Ordinance Regarding Vehicles and Traffic, amend Chapter 240-108, Article 16, Parking Fees, Rates and Terms, Central Business District, East Section Only, filed April 22nd, 2015, related communication from Mayor Fiorentini.
Yes, and I'd like to add to that that the mayor would prefer us to send it to committee. He's not prepared to address it tonight, and that was always the plan.
And should we do 18.3 also, bundle them together, send them both?
Why not?
What committee?
So
Administration
we'll do
and Finance.
18.2 and 18.3. And
can't we go someplace? Can't it go to someplace?
And who made the motion?
I made it.
Councilor Ryan, and seconded by? We'll give
Councilor
you another
Daley
try
O'Brien.
To come in second here.
Councilor Daley O'Brien.
Councilor Daley O'Brien. And we do have one councilor that would like to speak. Councilor LePage.
No, it's passed now, Mr. President. I was just going to move it to a committee, but that's already passed. Thank
okay.
you.
Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Scatamaccia.
Yes.
Councilor Barrett.
Yes.
Councilor Masick.
Yes.
Councilor Ryan.
Yes.
Councilor Sullivan.
Yes.
Councilor Daley O'Brien.
Yes.
Councilor LePage.
Yes.
President Mitchison.
Yes.
8 yeas, 0 nays, 1 absent.
And that passes. Next item.
Communication from Councilor Ryan requesting a discussion regarding the full reopening of the Route 110 park.
Councilor Ryan.
Thank you. I was hoping the mayor was still here. I'm not sure if he wants to come in and actually my remarks were directed to him. I'm not sure he's probably happy that I'm Mayor. I was hoping you were here. This is regarding the Hannah Dustin Park down on Route 110.
I'm sending a letter of non-opposition regarding the Hannah Dustin Park.
And
Mayor.
See, very good. You did that on your own. Touché, Counselor.
This is probably one of the finest pieces of land adjacent to the river in the city of Haverhill.
Absolutely.
And I had residents ask me if I would bring this to the city council and to lobby you. Number one, it's a historic, it's where Hannah Dustin, who got freed, was taken by Native Americans as a slave, along with a young boy from Haverhill, and were able to come down the river. What happened in between, we don't know if it's the truth or not, and I won't go into it, but she certainly was a very brave woman and went through an awful lot of very tough conditions, but made it her way back to Haverhill, and that is where she landed with the young boy and made it back to her farm up, Hilldale Avenue, or wherever she was living at the time. But it's really a very famous, we really should make more of it. I know there are people that, there are detractors because of
It's open, Bill.
I know, but I think we should maintain it as a city and not just, it's the only park in the city that we don't maintain by the Department of Public
Works. Oh, sure we
works.
Do. Oh, we do a lot there.
But I mean, it should be real full. And you've done a lot of playgrounds throughout the city. What a great spot for one of your playgrounds.
Yes, thanks.
You know, I mean, I know some of them.
Every one of which you've opposed.
I would really support you on this. I'll make the motion. But I thought it's a great location.
For a playground?
For a playground.
Why don't we have a community meeting out there and let's discuss it? We've talked about a playground out there. Some people for it, some against. Because it all has to fit within the budget. We've talked about putting in for a park grant out there. Personally, I like the park grant. I want to fix Riverside Park. You'll be hearing about that. And we've talked about a dog park out there. All good possibilities.
Mayor, even if we did, we had Public Works people who were very talented to make some benches and a few seesaws and a couple of swings. It doesn't have to be expensive.
Well, yes, it does. Yeah. Under the new, it isn't like it that yeah. anymore, Bill.
Under disabilities.
Benches, yes, we can do that. But the playground equipment, unfortunately, is expensive because they have all these new regulations.
Yeah,
I agree with that. I'm not against it in any way. I love that park. I'm proud of, you know.
But it should, all the barriers gone. It should be open up completely.
After previous mayors closed it.
Right. I've always supported it. I thought it was a great park. It had to be somebody in between. But I wanted to bring that up, and I was going to ask the council president to maybe send you a letter. A formal, he's...
Oh, save the stamp. Sure.
Save the stamp, and that's why I was hoping you'd come.
Well, let's continue that discussion. I'm for doing more with that park.
Right.
Absolutely. And we finally... I didn't want to open it up last year because I wanted to be certain that the lights are on and that the cameras are there. And I'll double-check with the chief, but as far as I know, we finally got National Grid to wire them, and I think that's all set. Do you know, Tom, offhand, if the lights are set up?
I don't know yet.
You're our playground expert.
I'm not a playground expert for this particular piece, but I am. My light is on because I support what Councilor Ryan is saying. I do want to see that park completed. It's half done, and half done is half done.
Yeah. The only thing I'm worried about, all kidding aside, I don't know why I'm in a playful mood after that last discussion, but I am. But the only thing that I'm concerned about is it was shut 20 years ago, whoever was the mayor that shut it, for good reason. And that was that if you go down into some of those more remote areas of the park, they're not viewable from the street. And we all know that bad things happen when you can't see things from the street. So that's why we've tried to have a little more of partway approach on this. We've opened it up a little bit more each year. Last year, after the council spoke, I had a public meeting. We went out to Mike's Phoenician restaurant out there, and a lot of neighbors came. And somebody came from the police force. I can't remember if it was Captain Ratty or Deputy Thompson or who it was. But they very strongly recommended against opening the whole park. They said, you know, there's areas there that you can't see. We can't easily patrol them.
We should cut all that brush out.
Right.
Well, we did. We cut a lot back. But no matter what you cut back, there are areas that are awfully tough to see and to patrol. But let's take a look at it. I agree we can open more of it, and I'm prepared to do that. Whether I want to open the whole thing is another story.
Well, I mean, I think there's you've been very successful in using prison labor,
yep.
You know, court probation labor.
It's not a money issue.
There are lots of resources out there, but I think of all the parks, Winnie Kenny, the stadium, and that one, there's a lot of passion for that park.
Well, there's a lot of passion with one guy that talks to you, but there's a...
No, that was actually the lady that lives across the street.
Oh, two guys that talk to you.
So it's now, it's up to two, but, you know, when this, you've been in politics long enough, if two people are speaking to you, you can magnify, there's probably several hundred.
We had a neighborhood meeting.
Actually are interested
in this. We had a neighborhood meeting, they were mixed. I'm all for opening it, whether we want to open it all the way. I want to check.
We close it if it gets out of hand.
Well, we did have an incident there last year. It didn't get publicized. I'm not sure I want it to, but, you know, there was a problem there last year.
Sounds like, I think if you look at police records, every park in the city, there's probably been an incident. So why pick on that park alone? That's not the only place. I mean, it happens everywhere, and we just have to get more policemen and patrol the city better. But we need to open it up. It's a resource that's begging for us to put into use.
We'll use the, sounds like we're going to need that letter.
We'll use the money from the host agreement.
Well, I'm going to ask you, Mr. President, to send a mail to remind him about this discussion.
That is a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Councilor Daley O'Brien, and we do have one other person that would like to speak, Councilor LePage.
Thank you, Mr. President. Actually, Alice Mann is here, and with all the notes I have here, I kind of misplaced my paper, but when I saw this on the agenda, and I support Councilor Ryan with this, also Portland Street Playground, there's some still open items on that, and with the mayor here and Alice here, is hoping to, if it wasn't a letter, if we can just do it now, I believe there's a punch list of things that they're looking to finish up on. You work with Team Haverhill, they've done quite a bit of work down there, and now it's just a matter of maintenance, painting lines, if I can remember, painting lines on the basketball court, putting a pad for the bubbler to be down there, testing out that the water supply is not leaking, so when they do put in a concrete pad, planting trees, trash cans, I believe, and curb, and I'm sorry, Alice, that's just off the top of my head of the punch list that you gave me. Just, they would like to have those things done. They're going to have an event in a couple of weeks for, I think, maybe with the Boys Club. They're having a basketball tournament and such. So if we just take care of those things, we were hoping to do it when we met with folks down there before Earth Day, and that was 4 or 5 weeks ago. So, again, if we could attach that letter to Council Ryan's one for the other park, I'd like to have those there also and hopefully get these things taken care of relatively quick now that the spring is finally here.
That one I do want a letter on, so I can send that
over
to DPW.
You'll get a letter on both, right. Mr.
And
Mayor.
Mayor, if this does pass, you'll be batting 500 on letters tonight.
Better than Ted Williams.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Did I miss anything else? I got all the points? Okay. Thank you.
Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Scatamaccia.
Yes.
Councilor Barrett.
Yes.
Councilor Masick.
Yes.
Councilor Ryan.
Yes.
Councilor Sullivan.
Yes.
Councilor Daley O'Brien.
Yes.
Councilor LePage.
Yes.
President Mitchison.
Yes.
8 yeas, 0 nays, 1 absence.
That passes. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And committee reports, Councilor LePage.
Thank you, Mr. President. We held a meeting of the Administration and Finance Committee on April 22nd. Quite a few folks were there, Mr. President. Committee members, myself, Councilor Masick, Councilor Mayor Ellen Daley O'Brien, and Councilor McGonigal, also Councilor Barrett and Councilor Sullivan also attended. We had Department Head City Solicitor William Cox, City Clerk Linda Catullus, and Police Officer Lance Powell, and we had 18 folks from the public, the general public. The first item that we discussed was an ordinance relating to peddling and soliciting, Section 191-9, licenses. Add at the end of subsection A, permitted to location, food trucks of any size may be allowed at all permitted fixed locations with approval from City Council. The committee reviewed the materials provided previously, City of Boston food truck regulations, and had a lengthy discussion concerning the following aspects of a proposed ordinance, including but not limited to A, the definition of a food truck, which will be no larger than 8 feet by 30 feet, B, City Council approval required for location, not to be in the central business / restaurant district unless a special event, C, the fee of $50 per day, not to exceed $500 per applicant per calendar year. D, not violate the city noise ordinance nor negatively impact quality of life. A motion was made to accept the amendments and request City Solicitor Cox to prepare the ordinance for full council review. That passed unanimously. The second item on our agenda was a communication from Councilor Masick requesting to discuss the taxi cab and buses ordinance. The committee received comments from the police chief to the draft ordinance submitted for his review. Comments included the location of driver identification within the taxi cab, as well as the inspecting and approval authority of taxi meters. The committee recommends that the city sealer of weights and measures be the responsible party. A motion was made to accept the amendments and request city solicitor Cox to prepare the notice for full council review. That passed unanimously. The last item on the agenda was document 10B, a communication from Councilor Barrett requesting to discuss lack of city representation on HC Media Board of Directors. The committee received and discussed the newly amended, which were dated April 8th, 2015, HCTV bylaws, which supersedes the previously amended bylaws dated January 15th, 2014, and increases the number of directors as well as restores the set aside seats as were in their previous old bylaws. I will spare you, Mr. President, and the rest of the council, all the reading of the bylaws, the two sections that I have here, but they are in the minutes and they will be available. With that, let's see, the nominating committee shall, I'll just read the last end of it, was the nominating committee shall review applications for nomination. Actually, no, I'm sorry. Let me summarize. Basically, what has happened is in the amendments before that we had in front of the council or talked about prior council meeting, where the four set-aside seats were taken away, they were now put back in. And they increased from 11 people on the Board of Directors to 13. Nine directors being at large, four directors shall be representatives of the following organizations. Given that a suitable recommendation is presented to the nominating committee in writing by the following individuals: Mayor of the City of Haverhill, B, Director of Haverhill Public Library, C, the Superintendent of Haverhill Public Schools, and D, the President of Northern Essex Community College. The term of office for a new director shall be as follows: first time elected service for 1 year, second time elected service for 2 years, third time elected service for 3 years. The terms for all subsequent elections shall be 3 years. They also had, where they changed a little bit in their bylaws, was the nominating committee shall review applications for nomination and recommend names of nominees to the Board of Directors for a vote. Once approved by the Board of Directors, an acceptable slate of nominees shall be presented to the members of the at the annual meeting of members for election by a simple majority of affirmative votes. Representative of the Board of Directors also informed that the eligibility and approval criteria, and I'm sorry, this is from the minutes, used by the nominating committee in determining the suitability of the four representative director recommendations set aside seats has not yet been finalized. With the reinstatement of city representatives to the HC Media Board of Directors, a motion was made and passed to consider the matter closed. Those are the minutes from the Administration and Finance meeting of April 22nd.
Thank you very much, Councilor.
Have those accepted and placed on file?
Yes. Motion by Councilor LePage, seconded by Councilor Daley O'Brien. And discussion, Councilor Barrett.
Hi, thank you, Mr. President. I was just, you know, we went through this. It seems to have cleared up, but I would like the council to send a letter to the mayor asking him to reassemble the cable advisory committee. The contract isn't up for a number of years, but it's no time like the present to start thinking about what's to come and how we will proceed. You know, technology is changing all the time. We might as well have a group installed and ready to act.
Councilor LePage, can we add that to your motion?
Yes, I'd second that.
And the second from Councilor Daley O'Brien.
Yes, of course.
Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Scatamaccia.
Yes.
Councilor Barrett.
Yes.
Councilor Masick.
Yes.
Councilor Ryan.
Yes.
Councilor Sullivan.
Yes.
Councilor Daley O'Brien.
Yes.
Councilor LePage.
Yes.
President Richardson.
Yes.
8 yeas, 0 nays, 1 absent.
And that passes. Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Councilor Daley O'Brien, seconded by Councilor Barrett. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? We're adjourned.